I might need a gummy.
From the Gettysburg Museum of History Studios, high atop Baltimore Street, in a maximum security facility complete with central air, it's AG Today.
Hello, folks. It's Patrick Gorman.
Hi, this is Jake Busey.
Hi, this is Bruce Boxleitner.
This is Tom Vera from A Gettysburg Christmas.
Hi, this is Bo Brinkman.
And you're listening to Addressing Gettysburg.
I'm glad you're listening. Thank you.
There's a devil to pay.
Did you start that blinking?
Bullshit. Good night, everybody.
Bonfire.
You're listening to
Bird Today.
I love this podcast.
Hello, exactly.
Nuga. Chaganuga.
Bonfire.
Right, but that's it. You hit the nail on the head. You bitches up for food? You sexist bitch.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to this late-starting AG Today. It's summer, man. It's summer, and we're going to start late if we want to. That's the bottom line, right? Because it's fun. We're sitting in here. We're just talking. Everybody's catching up.
Actually melted my watch. I didn't know what time it was, so it was kind of like,
really, it was so
like,
late.
Yeah, it's like,
oh, it's so hot out there though.
It is crazy.
Oh, sorry, hold on, Colby. Sorry, I had you muted.
Did it actually melt your watch though?
No,
not really.
I mean, I was gonna be a little surprised.
You were the one walking around town in a flannel shirt, so
hey man, you gotta look good when you record, you know. Right. And I recorded it.
As you can tell, you gotta look good.
Plug here. We recorded an episode about Audie Murphy, which
An episode about Audie Murphy. Welcome back, Colby, by the way.
Thanks, buddy. I missed you guys.
Yeah, we missed you too. I'll tell you, I was while you were gone the last 2 weeks, I was floating in a sea of estrogen.
We talked about that. I said I was going to bring a testy blitz, dude.
Testy blitz. Yeah, well, unfortunately, at my advanced age, it's not what it used to be. So we're like a third of the...
Well, listen, it's not the size of the lion. It's the size of the fight in the lion, you know?
I don't know what the hell you're talking about. Colby is a little medicated tonight, ladies and gentlemen.
Don't bring me in on this, Colby. That's what I'm talking about.
I saw your face, young Marines over there.
Oh, yeah, well, until I found out they were 12.
Oh, yeah, I forgot
Sounded
about
sexy.
That.
Sounded sexy. Sexist bitch.
Yeah, that's right. She was all excited about the young Marines, and they turned out to be way too young Marines.
I'm gonna be honest. Sad part is I was excited about them too. I thought I was gonna get to talk some Marine stuff, and I didn't. Then I found out they're.
No, you would have scared the hell out of them.
Good on them, though. You know, I love like the program. I'm not crap talking the program here. You notice my like, I really watched what I said right there, so we don't get any craziness later on in the comments.
What the hell did you take before you came in here, Colby?
I took a ton of testosterone. Getting ready for this stuff, man. Bringing it fast, hot, and heavy.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, dude. Look at you. You're excited I'm back.
Oh, no, I'm excited you're back. I just, I didn't know you brought an extra Colby with you. That's all.
Double the Colby, double the Marine.
That's right. There you go. Double your pleasure with double mint gum. But listen, we would like... We would like to say that, you know, it is good to have you back. Colt.
I'm glad to be back. I really am, man. I missed this.
But it's also, you know, I'm sorry that you were gone because you had some deaths in the family.
You know, listen, life is good when you have them. It's part of life, man. You know, I've been around of my fair share of death, and I have a very comfortable relationship with it.
Yes, that's true. You probably have been exposed to it a little more than the average bear, I would say, correct?
Not all the bears, you know, but a good majority probably.
Well, the average
know,
ones.
Especially in a condensed time frame.
You
know,
yes.
That's not to include everybody's, you know, but yeah, I've had a more than usual exposure to it, for sure.
There you go.
You know?
There you go. Well, I'm sorry that this was so personal, though. These were two close deaths that you had there. And Cam, too, he had a couple of deaths in the family last week.
Wait, what happened with Cam's family?
Two of his cousins died one day after another. And so he had to deal with that last week. So, yeah, I mean, it's tough for everybody. But, you know, everybody's pulling through. That's the key. You got to pull through, right?
Have you seen Cam recently?
I have not seen Cam recently. No, but interestingly enough, I'll tease this for later. He, you know, you went down to Harper's Ferry to see him speak at a...
The round table.
Mm-hmm. And I said, please bring this recorder down and record him so that we have that. And she did it. She brought it down, recorded it. When was that? Was that in the fall?
It was a while ago. You guys had something. You had something else going with Eric, I think. You guys had something else going on.
So was it late summer or spring?
I don't remember, to be honest.
I'll have to check the date on the recording.
That we stood outside and talked when we left the program for a while. Like, that's all I remember. So it wasn't really cold. It wasn't really hot. It was.
So it must have been spring or fall.
Like,
okay.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, and Cam's always say, "Hey, are you saying Veronica and Kathy down to record my thing, and you ain't never played it on your show? Why not?" And I said, honestly, Cam, you know, nobody believes the swamp dragons were real. I think you made them up, number one. Number two, nobody cares about West Virginia, you know. And then he got all, like, red in the face, and his hair started.
No, he didn't.
Yeah. Right. Colby's holding him back and everything. And so I, you know, finally I said, all right, I'm just kidding. The truth of the matter is, I didn't listen to it because, you know, I don't have the time. It's like, what, an hour and a half, something like that. I didn't have the time to sit around and listen to that. I have my own recordings that I make to do that. Yeah. But this month I've had somewhat off, and I had the time to do it. I listened. And so I pulled a couple of clips. I'll put the whole interview, or not the whole, the whole lecture on Patreon, so you can learn a little bit about the swamp dragons, ladies and gentlemen. But in the meantime, we'll have the whatchamacallit on there, the
audio.
In the next segment, I'm going to play a couple of clips tease. So go ahead.
No, I was just going to say I feel bad that, you know, he did a visual aid with it. Obviously, there was a slide presentation and everything that was presented if you were in the audience. I didn't have the capability of recording that or whatever. We just did the audio, but Kim did a good job.
Oh, I'm sure he still has that slideshow.
I'm sure, yeah. I don't see why he wouldn't.
Yeah.
I bet he's all about it. Here's my slideshow.
Well, that would be another thing. If I had the time, I'd say, give me the slideshow and I'll set it to the audio for you and make a video out of it. But
it's a lot of work, yeah.
It's a lot of work, yeah.
Slideshows are wildly much more difficult than video.
I agree, because you got to stretch the photo out. Yeah. It is a pain in the butt to do that. I'm over video editing. What do you got there, Veronica? What are you looking at? Something caught your eye.
No, I was just looking at the comments.
Oh, yeah, I know. What? Anything good?
Just people wishing us Alderson Broderson.
Alderson Broderson to all of you, ladies and gentlemen. Alderson Broderson to you. And may I say, Alderson Broderson to you while I see you on the Chaganooga Choo Choo.
Chaganooga.
Yes, that's actually from one of the lectures. So Bethany is here with us today. Yes. Bethany Yingling, who normally sits in for Ronnie. Now, Ronnie, you were not going to be here today,
right.
But then what you were going to do with the roundtable, they rescheduled because of the heat,
right.
I guess.
Yeah, it was postponed. The Wheatfield tour with Larry Korzick was supposed
Korchek.
to Kor-
Czech.
Czech, sorry.
Czech.
Czech.
He told me, he corrected me.
Court
check.
Oh. Court check.
Think of like the check that you pay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Court check. Is that how he described it?
That's how he described it, yep. And that's how I remember it.
Hunky, I thought I knew my stuff. I don't
know. Yeah, well, you almost did. But okay, so go ahead.
Court check.
So they're not doing it.
So anyway, it's way too hot. I think that kind of they made a determination yesterday to postpone it to the rain date, ironically enough, which is Monday.
Okay.
So we'll be doing it on Monday.
Okay.
Where it will actually rain.
Maybe. No. Yeah, right. Then I don't know.
So they postponed it, and so you're able to come here tonight, but you because what is it, like 90, what is it? I don't have it's 95 degrees right now, and it's 5:30, 5:50.
It was supposed to start at 6, so
It's pretty hot out there. Although there is a nice breeze. It doesn't seem that bad. It's been worse because the cloud cover is helping, I think. It would be like 110 if we just had clear skies.
It's pretty hot out.
Oh, it's hot. Don't get me wrong. Yeah. It's hot, but it's not, crazy hot. But anyway, you were like, oh, no. Don't. If Bethany's there, I'll be back next week. I said, no. We'll have you both on, and we'll talk about That's What She Said, because that is something that we were working on over the winter. We've got a few episodes in the can, and we'll talk to you guys about that a little bit. Now, let's do that now.
Hold on. Can we pause for 1 second?
Okay, hold on. Pause.
Do a shout out to my niece, Katie, who just wrote Hi, Tiki.
Aw, sure. I thought you were bringing her.
Well, unfortunately, we had an issue with daycare, so she's actually watching Ezra. So when I got home.
How old's your niece?
14.
Oh, okay. I was picturing like little
she's
girl.
14.
Okay, all right, all right.
I got home. She had Ezra up for a nap. She had cleaned his bedroom. She had done all this work at the house. She's the cutest thing in the history of things.
So she likes cleaning?
She does. I wonder where she gets that
from. Like, she's like her Aunt Bethany. Yeah.
I wonder where she gets that
Aunt
from.
Bethany.
Aunt Tiki.
Yeah, I was going to say, where'd the tiki? Did I miss that?
Because one time Bethany accidentally knocked over a tiki torch and set the house on fire.
Close.
Is your a torch? No. You're a torch of a gal. No, go ahead. Why?
So my mom didn't want to be grandma. She didn't feel like that was appropriate for her personality, which is true.
Yeah.
So she went and looked through all of the languages and what they call grandma. And she found that in Filipino, it is Lola, which she was like, well, that works.
L-O-L-A, Lola.
She goes, because what Lola wants, Lola gets. And I was like, well, I want a fun name. So we came up with Aunt Tiki. It has morphed into because I'm an antique. Katie always said that I should open my own antique store, Antiquey's Antiques.
That's cute. Mm-hmm.
That's actually a great idea.
That's cute.
Antiquey's Antiques. I like that. Yeah. You should do that.
She's the cutest kid.
Or you should buy one of the antique stores when they retire, and then just change the name.
There you go.
Antiquey's That's a good idea. Antiques. No, we don't need any more antique stores. We have plenty. All right, so that's what she said. So this was actually the brainchild of my friend Amy. I got to give credit where credit's due. She said, you should do a show about women in Gettysburg called That's What She Said. And I was like, what a great idea. So I said, well, I know who is going to host it. Of course, Ronnie Ronstadt and Bethany Yingling. Who else would it be?
Uh-huh.
And I remember
How that went down.
Well, that's in my head. That's how it went down. And then I asked you if you wanted to do it. And you had 100 excuses till Sunday why you couldn't, right?
No.
Like you wouldn't be able to. Not that you didn't have the time.
No, I just thought that I am not known. I'm not like Veronica. I'm not famous.
So, get out of here.
But Veronica wasn't famous before.
More people know you. You had somebody come up
and ask for your autograph.
No, he was pulling my leg. That was cute. That was really nice.
Who was that?
You're putting me on the spot.
Tom.
Tom, thank you.
Tom Canavan?
No. Cone Sweet Cone?
Tom Schultz.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
He was joking around.
Ironically, I was at an event at the museum.
So I was there to witness her autograph.
Okay, so you got but still, by the way, when Veronica started this, she wasn't famous.
I'm still not famous. I don't know.
Oh, please. You're such a diva now. Everybody's like, oh, make way for Veronica. Veronica's coming through.
Veronica.
Yeah.
sugar.
Two creams, one sugar. What? What is that?
I know her coffee. She's a diva. And I know her coffee.
Oh. Only green M&Ms.
How do you take your coffee, by the way?
I don't drink coffee.
You don't drink coffee?
She drinks Monster Energy drinks.
I quit a couple of years ago, but when Bantam Roasters became a sponsor, I started drinking it again.
That's
we do
hot cocoa there. Yeah. We do the flavored tea.
I do like the teas.
You're a cocoa kind of person.
But everybody loves coffee, and everybody's like, it's so good, it's so good. I go, well, I got to try it. So I tried it, and I go, this actually is good. And I said, okay, I'll keep drinking coffee. Well, because I can never tell what a good cup of coffee is. People go, oh, it's just good coffee, or oh, this is crap coffee. And I'm like, how do you tell? Like, it's all the same to me. I have to pour half a bottle of vanilla creamer in it, which tells me I don't like coffee, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, it's true. If you have a good cup of coffee, then it's not bad.
That's where everyone I know goes.
Yeah, because it's really good. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Back to you guys.
Sorry.
So, yeah. So that's what she said. Now, we've recorded, I think, about four episodes.
No,
is that right? Is it five? Five?
Yeah.
Five or six. We were supposed to do six, but our guest never showed up. So we got five episodes in the can. Mm-hmm. And I think I saw one. We have one on Sunday.
Yes.
With Carolyn Ivanov about Clara Barton.
Yep.
And so
Clara Barton's awesome.
Or Barton, yeah. She is awesome. Awesome. She's an arsonist. And we're going to schedule some more for the rest of the year.
With Lisa Samia also scheduled later in August.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
I love Lisa Samia. She's so sweet.
You know, I was going through some old emails, actually, because I ran into Sue Boardman for some events over the weekend, and she had responded that she was willing to do these. And
Let's get her in here.
I need to follow up on that. Sue's... And there were some other folks.
I saw Sue on the battlefield giving a tour, and I almost interrupted it just because I love Sue so much that every time I see her, I have to say hi to her. She just brightens my day.
She's just a little ball of energy, man.
She is that.
Yeah.
She can also tell a freaking story, dude.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I know.
She's good.
Oh, and she's got such a funny outlook on life, and the opinions she has killed
well,
just kills me.
To be an ER nurse, so a lot of her stuff comes from just having to put up with other people's crap all the time.
She just doesn't have time for anybody's shit.
She
and I love that.
And I respect her more than I can possibly to say. She's wonderful.
Yeah, she is great. So okay, so we'll try to get her back on too. What I think I'm gonna do is I'm gonna tell Dave to coordinate with you guys. Cut me out of it. I'll just be here for the recordings because I have to get you in the building. But you guys work with Dave, whoever you want, and then he'll, you know, between the two of you and himself and me, we'll get contact information for whoever you want to get. You know, we have plenty of connections where we can get that for you. Mm-hmm. And you guys make it your own show. You don't need me to have my fingers in the... You guys, remember what I said after the first show? Do you remember what I said?
You said, I am awesome.
No.
You did.
Yeah.
I'm pretty
sort of
sure
like,
that happened.
I
am always right.
No. Wrong. I said... I am so proud.
Sounds about right, yeah.
I stood up and I clapped, right? And I said, ladies, I just have to say
I'm amazing.
That I am so proud of myself.
Yes, that's what
because I knew that you guys would be great, but I thought it might take some warming up, but right out of the gate, you were fantastic. And I meant that, and it's true, and it holds true.
You.
I was listening to some of the shows. You guys are really good at it, and I think people are going to like it, and it's going to be on Patreon. I'll put the first episode out in September. How's that sound?
Okay.
I'll put it out the third Wednesday of the month.
Dang.
Okay?
That's an official
third
day.
Wednesday of the month.
Write that down.
Write it down, girls, because I'll forget it. Third Wednesday of the month. And so that will not be instead of our normal uploads. That will be in addition to. Or should I make it instead of? Let's think about this for a second.
No.
Why don't... I don't know.
Well, that'll save me some. No, I don't think so. People will love it. I think they'll love it.
Well, I think they'll love getting the extra content.
Yeah, that's true.
They're going to be upset if you take something out.
Okay.
A little bit of like a plug for Patreon too. Like,
well, that's the whole idea.
Yeah. You're getting an extra.
I see what you're saying. You're getting an extra sugar-free gum. You're also getting. I shouldn't say that because people are going to expect. Extra in the mail, and you're not going to get any gum. if you become a patron to listen to this. But yeah, you're gonna get something extra over there. So if you're already a patron, stick around because you're gonna enjoy what the girls have here. What are some? I don't remember any of the guests. We had Deb McCausland.
Roseanne Zyka was the first that came on. She was the first one with bells on, and we appreciate that.
That's
Roseanne.
Right.
Oh, she was watches. And,
yeah, by the way, she's becoming a big star from her appearances on the anniversary shows.
Yeah,
and. We have an Ask a Gettysburg Town Guide scheduled to come out in August. So this is the summer of Zyko.
Yeah. So. She's just an awesome person.
Yeah, she is.
But yes, Deb McCausland was a guest.
Mm-hmm.
Deb Carolyn.
Navani. Carolyn Ivanov. Right, we already had her on for one thing, right?
Yeah, we did.
For who? What do you remember?
Am I allowed to say? I thought we were keeping it a secret.
Is it a big...
I don't know. What do we want to
No, do? We don't have to keep it a secret. No. Who did she talk about? What is happening?
Well, I was told that it was a secret.
It was?
A Patreon to do it. But if you want
me
to say.
No, I could tell you. You could say who it is. How are they going to want to join?
Cornelia Hancock.
Cornelia Hancock. That's right. Okay.
Or Carolyn Cornelia Hancock is what I was going to say.
Cornelia. So she talked about her. And then Deb Novotny was on to talk about the Powers sisters. Right? Mm-hmm.
Deb McCausland talked about Kitty Payne.
Kitty Payne. And then I had Deb on to talk about Yellow Hill, which is really interesting, too. Yeah.
She's done a lot of research on that. A lot of work on the African-American history around. And then finally we had Dr. Oh, my God.
Ashley Lusky.
Thank
you. Oh, Lusky, yes.
Yeah.
About Verena Davis.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So kind of a wide-ranging topic. I think if we're being honest, I think
we initially
thought that the way we could do this is talk about the women of Gettysburg, maybe season one,
right.
Expand to maybe the Civil War women, season two, then expand to Adams County. But candidly, it's very difficult to find guests that are quote unquote experts mm-hmm. in a specific woman's story or woman's issue, such as, how did they attach themselves to the Civil War here at Gettysburg or an army here at Gettysburg or what were their specific experiences here at Gettysburg? So we're kind of, I think,
already doing
a little bit of a mishmash. And folks like Kitty Payne, that was her story technically was pre-Civil War, mm-hmm. had a huge impact on
sure.
what a female's experience was like, the Powers sisters after the battle. Well, I'm sure we're going to have some folks talk about, there were recommendations about, obviously, Tilly Pierce and, Jenny Wade and those kinds of more known stories. But I think I'm really excited about kind of bringing some of these other women and some of the maybe not considered or not really given enough time about, what exactly their experiences were or who they were. Oh, Elizabeth Thorne. That was, that was Roseanne's. I mean, just these fascinating stories that maybe people have heard about, but there were some pretty badass women.
There really were.
I mean, like.
And I was there when you guys were recording all these, but I was just sitting in the room, like surfing the net or whatever. And I was listening. I had the headphones on. I was listening to the stories and stuff. And it made me realize that I don't think women were these shrinking violets like we're led to believe, right? Like, they were tough. Like, it was a tough life back then. So, maybe the man was, like, more in charge in society. But women weren't just sitting there going, They were, like, part of it. Especially if you talk about westward expansion and out on the plains and the prairies. Like, those chicks were tough.
They were not Aunt Pity Pat.
No.
Like, that is what, everybody always thinks about women. Oh, Uncle Peter, my smelling salts.
Right.
And when Roseanne was talking about Elizabeth Thorne, I can honestly tell you that I knew she was pregnant.
Yeah.
I knew she had helped bury bodies. I knew that she had talked to some of the generals about where things were located. But you take her outside of the battle.
Yeah.
Her life was fascinating.
Yeah.
And she did not back down once.
Yeah.
And I was just, my jaw was on the floor. I was just like, this woman is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm excited for the Sally Myers story. She's one of my favorites, and I think we actually have a couple experts that have shown some interest or willingness to come in and talk. But I actually think Sue Boardman, that was one of the people, but I'm pretty sure Tim Smith and some other folks have said, because she has a pretty interesting story, too, and not just Civil War related, but right after and some mm-hmm. tragedy and stuff. And then even the rest of her life, she was really a big advocate for different things. And I'm not going to spoil it or anything, but yeah.
She
dies in the end. Really, yeah, she dies in the end, unfortunately. But no, you know, I agree. I mean, we hear these stories like you said, the smelling salts or whatever. But if you really think about it, look, there were prostitutes. There were women that were dressing up like soldiers. There were, I mean, you have the whole gamut of things that you see today, right?
Well, and I'm looking forward to the prostitute show. That'll be a fun one.
Maybe overall society, right? Maybe overall society had different norms or expectations mm-hmm. of what was appropriate, what wasn't appropriate, right. That kind of stuff. And that shifted a bit. But overall, I mean, women were women, man. And we can kind of take care of it if you give us a chance, right?
Of course. Yeah.
I was actually thinking about this last night because Katie and I were watching the movie For Richer or Poorer. It has Tim Allen and Kirstie Alley.
I remember that one, yeah.
And they end up
the
in
late
Amish
Kirstie Alley
in Lancaster County and pretending to be Amish. And
so it's your classic fish out of water story.
Exactly. She talks in the movie. Kirstie Alley says something about, you know, these women can do all of this stuff. And I can't even sew on a button. And I'm sitting there thinking, this is exactly what I think when I'm listening to these stories.
Right,
because these women did all of that stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting here complaining because Ezra doesn't clean up his room. You know, like I'm just like the worst.
Like, I know. I wish
I had the ability. I can't sew on a button. I tried once. It fell off immediately. And these
the thing is, guys, you know, you read about the guys in the army. They had, what do they call the sewing kit? The housewife? Yeah. They had that with them. And they knew how to sew. Mm-hmm. I can't sew.
Yeah.
And you would think, that, well, why would that make you feel like less of a man? It's because a real man doesn't go, that's woman's work. A real man knows how to do everything. Mm-hmm. You know, cowboys, right? We think of cowboys, oh, manly men and everything like that. Well, who was going along in the chuck wagon cooking for him? It wasn't a woman. Yeah. It was a dude. And he was a pretty damn good cook. Yeah. And he fed all these guys. So there's nothing wrong with cooking. There's nothing wrong with cleaning. I hate them. I love to cook. I'm not very good at it, but I love to cook. You know, like, you know, hit 3 minutes on the microwave. And cleaning, I'm horrible at that because it's just there's so many better things I could be doing with my time, like taking a nap with my puppy or something like that, you know. But anyway, so that's what she said. It's going to start. It's going to premiere on.
We have a red carpet.
You want to?
Oh my gosh! Right outside here.
We'll get
in
some
alley.
Dye and in the
have
alley.
A red carpet. I'll wear a dress and walk down the alley. Going,
oh, can we do that? Let's do that. And nobody's there.
Yeah.
Like nobody's there to see us. It's just.
I don't know. Maybe we can have the guests all come. We could all parade.
Yeah. You
know? Yeah, well, let's make a big deal out of it that no one cares about. Because that's funny to me.
And then, like, we'll have a background of people, like, clapping and going, woo! And then we'll turn to the behind us and there's no one there. I love it.
Oh, that's funny. Well, anyway, so third Wednesday of the month is going to be That's What She Said Day, and September is the first one. Do you have a suggestion? Would you want me to do the one that you recorded first? Because I think you acknowledge it's the first one.
Yeah, we acknowledge that in there.
So we'll do that one first, which was, who was that?
That was
Elizabeth Thorne. That's right. So we'll do that. And
it's like he wasn't even there.
Yeah, 5 minutes ago.
I literally
just talking about that too. Little Rosie.
Don't even know where I am at this moment. So how am I supposed to remember anything?
There's this town called Gettysburg.
No, I know I'm in Gettysburg. I just don't know where in Gettysburg I am. That's all.
Studios awesomely provided by...
Yes, that's right. By the Gettysburg Museum of History. And if you look behind Veronica, Colby, go in on a close-up. Not a close-up, but a one-shot of Ronnie there, if you don't mind. Look at that. Fierce Valor by Jared Frederick and Eric Dorr. The true story of Ronald Spears and his band O Brothers. Folks, I just skimmed through. Just you're okay. Hold on a second. You're going to make people throw up. I just kind of skimmed through this, and I read different, you know, chapters or bits of chapters and everything like that. And let me tell you something. This guy, and Eric and I have talked about him too. This guy was fascinating. Oh, we also interviewed Eric and Jared on Patreon about this book when it came out. So you can catch that. When did that come out? I can't remember. It was last year sometime, if I'm not mistaken. I don't remember if it was summer or not, or might have been, I don't remember if it was cold or whatever. But the point is, It's really fascinating. The movie, not the movie, the show, Band of Brothers does a great job with Captain Spears. That's one of my favorite characters in the whole thing. But his real life, his whole life is very fascinating, and it's way bigger than that, and you got to check it out. You were going to say?
There's another book that they wrote, too, right?
Hang Tough.
There we go. Thank
that was
you.
The Dick Winters book.
Thank you.
I don't have a copy of that, otherwise I'd have that up there, too. And then The Heaven's Falling is the other one. It's Jonathan Lucci, who's a new sponsor to the show.
Let's do this.
And that will be updated in the, once I get back to work next week, yeah. We will have new commercials.
Yeah. And look at this. Yeah. It is huge.
It is so a huge one. It's a novel.
Now that fall's coming.
Yeah. And I did read the first chapter of that one.
I enjoyed it.
Did
you just say now that fall is coming?
I'm trying to think it into existence. My fat ass is not loving this weather, man. I am like, God. I can
Dragon.
Feel myself kind of just be like worn out. Yet. I know. I was doing some weeding the other day. Forget it. 20 minutes
well,
required like a 2-hour nap.
Weed makes weed slows like, you down and it makes you dopey. Right. Listen, look at Colby. He's asleep already.
Hey, right? I've been doing work on these cameras though.
Oh, okay. What have you been doing? Well, it doesn't matter. We got to take a break. So we'll take our first break and we'll
Aren't
be right back.
Are you glad you used Dial? We are too. We'll be right back.
Want the freshest cup of coffee in Gettysburg? Then visit Bantam Roasters, formerly 82 Cafe at 82 Steinware Avenue. They roast all of their coffee in-house, and they have a full coffee bar to keep you caffeinated during your trip. Visit them at www.raggededgerc.com for their menu and shipping options for all of their freshly roasted coffee. Use promo code Hancock for 10% off your order in the cafe.
Enjoy historical stories on the History Fix platform. Explore movies, short films, and documentaries. Addressing Gettysburg podcast fans receive an extra $5 off the first year's annual subscription. Sign up at historyfix.com and use promo code Gettysburg. Every subscription includes a 7-day risk-free trial. Escape into history with History Fix.
This episode of Addressing Gettysburg is brought to you in part by me, audiobook narrator Mike Scott. Narrator of Savis Beattie's Bloody Autumn, the Shenandoah Valley Campaign of 1864, and Unlike Anything That Ever Floated, The Monitor and Virginia and the Battle of Hampton Roads. If you are an author or publisher interested in having your titles produced as audiobooks, or even just in learning more about the process, give me a shout. You can find my contact info on my website, MikeScottVoice.com. That's MikeScottVoice.com.
The 1863 civilians of Gettysburg were reluctant witnesses to the great battle. Join Ken Rich, the man in the red shirt, for his historic town walking tours. You could book these tours by emailing ken@gettysburgtownhistory.com. That's ken@gettysburgtownhistory.com. And when you're in town, look for the guy in the red shirt.
And Civil War Trails. It's the world's largest open-air museum, and they offer over 1,300 sites across 6 states. Drive the Gettysburg campaign turn by turn, paddle to Frederick Douglass's birthplace, or hike to remote earthworks and artillery positions. Visit CivilWarTrails.org to request a brochure and explore their interactive map. Follow Civil War Trails and create some history of your own.
You're listening to the Addressing Gettysburg podcast with Matt Callery.
Listening to the man who refuses to travel while single. I love that I never read these before I start doing them. Okay, alright. You're listening to the man who refuses to travel while single. Here's Matt.
Thank you, Huevos Grande. You know what that means in Spanish?
Big egg.
Big eggs, that's right. Big huevos. Okay, so let's see here. Well, let's see. I got two choices for you, ladies. You tell me what you want first. We're going to do them both.
Well, that was...
Is that one of the options?
It was Chinese or pizza. That's right.
Because I want chocolate.
Chocolate. Ooh, yeah. Well, then we can go to Mexican and you can get the mole sauce on it. No, here, listen. Would you rather...
learn what mole sauce was.
Like 2 weeks ago. Yeah. Would you rather see...
Young Marines.
Young Marines or young Matt with long hair and a plaid suit homecoming? I don't blame you. Colby, can you get some young Marines in here,
right,
please?
Would you get to the point? Quit messing around. I don't understand.
Yeah, we're trying to be serious.
So you'll remember that when Javier Sandoval was on the other day, we were talking about zany wear, and I was telling him about this plaid suit that I got for homecoming senior year. And then also the other thing is, again, we mentioned this before, Cameron and his lectures. I have to tell you, I listened to it, and this is something I didn't tell anybody before. When now you'll recall that when he did the winter lecture after Matt Atkinson, and you know, we put it out, we put the audio out. They didn't put the video out because they knew this.
Yeah,
and that is that he works a little blue, if you know what I mean, in his lectures. And I had to do a lot of cutting out when we released the winter lecture. Because of how many curses,
at least PG-13. I was surprised they allowed that. Yeah.
Yeah. And so what the question is, what do you want to, hear that first, or do you want to just get through the pictures real quick? I think we could spend less time on the pictures. So let's do that first. Okay. Colby, go to pictures, and what you're going to have to do, there you go. There's number one. Now to the left, there is we're left from right. We're going my friend, Greg. There's me with the plaid suit, and you can see nothing matches the plaid doesn't even match. It's different patterns because I went to a thrift store and I got that.
The guy next to you looks extremely
There's no way to zoom in on that.
Now there I am with my date and her.
You're not even like putting your arm around her.
Because we were posing.
Literally pose you with your arm around her, or like next to
you. No. This was in my living room.
You usually pose at least like with your arm around each other.
Well, there's other pictures of me with my arm around her, I'm sure, but this one, like, we wanted everybody to see our beautiful clothing.
Her dress is sassy.
But it was like velour.
Nice.
You know, like that velour.
She had to be hot. I mean, she.
Well, it was November.
So hard. Oh yeah.
Yeah, it was November. All right, Colby, what's the next one? Yeah, now this one here, that's my friend, left to right, it's my friend Jay, that's Courtney, Casey's the one in the middle, with the mouth of it, and then Brooke, and then there I am with that big mane of hair. Look at that beautiful mane of hair.
That's pretty amazing.
But you could see the hairline starting to retreat like the French army, and I was only 19 at that time. 19 years old. All right, see, Colby, what?
I remember you with hair.
Yeah, but it wasn't like this.
No, it was
now
short.
This, we were 15 or 16 here. And we were finger. So I had this attic, and it was.
What?
What? Careful, buddy.
I wish I had a bleep button. I would go along with you. We were finger painting.
Sure.
The door in my attic. So my attic was like my studio. We called it My Attic Studios, and that's where I did. That's where I invented the podcast, by the way. I had my karaoke machine, and every other week my friends and I would get together like we do on Friday or like we do on Thursdays, but we all got together on Friday nights and did our show, which was basically like this. I haven't changed in 60 years. Matt.
No, I listened to a show with you where you had a different name, you had a radio name.
Yes, Forest Green.
Was that it?
Yes. Yes, that's exactly what it was.
Mine's Abby Normal.
And you're Abby Normal, that's right. And Veronica is IP Freely. So, okay. So then, so we were finger painting the wall or the door.
What does that mean, finger painting it?
I'm sure your mother was thrilled.
So we had, no, because it was already, the attic wasn't finished. So it was like, there was like asbestos.
Your poor mom. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, man, she was a saint. I'll tell you, I think of what a pain in the ass I was and how like self-indulgent I was. Like if I, you know, music or whatever, like I just had to do it. Like I was, you know, I would just be like,
Mama,
I don't know what
Calorie,
the word.
We feel your pain.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you do. Anyway, while we were finger painting the door, she just takes her hand and goes, right across my face, and that started a finger paint fight, and that's why that picture had us covered in paint like that. So I figured,
go back to it,
Colby.
That was a girl? I missed that. I thought that, wait, seriously, I thought that was somebody in your, I thought you were saying that was, I totally missed that. It looks like a guy. I'm not trying to be funny. What?
That's mean.
No, it's not. I'm not trying to be mean. I thought that was like a friend of your band or something.
Terrible.
You sexist bitch.
You cannot zoom in on that.
You're talking, which one is the boy, which one is the girl, though?
You're on the right,
right? Oh, you can tell that's me. Okay. Yeah. All right. I think we both look like girls.
That's really well. Okay, so she smacks you.
She smacked me. You can see that, and you see the handprint on my shirt. That was later on. The first one is, I think, the one on the chin. That was the first one. And then it just, you know, and so this is us trying to clean up.
I think because the gray is making it look like she's got a beard.
Yeah, maybe.
It makes it look like she has a beard.
It does.
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
I can't see it very close. I misunderstood. I thought that was one of your buddies.
She's got to put her specs on.
No, it was not one of my buddies. My buddy and I would not be taking a picture like that with paint all over our faces. Okay? All right. So there we go. That is that for anybody who was wondering and wanted to see the thing there. What is it now?
I loved
okay.
it.
What?
I loved it.
Good.
It
I'm great. Glad you loved it. Now, let's get on to Cam here. So what I did was I was listening to his Harper's Ferry. It was a round table that he spoke at in Harper's Ferry that you went to. And I couldn't believe it. And this is why it's going on Patreon. I always say to people, you know, the free feed, YouTube, that's kind of like network television. Patreon, that's HBO. That is HBO. Okay. And so that's why the unedited version is going to go on Patreon in its entirety of his Harper's Ferry talk. However, I've got some clips here. God, first, let's see. I'll go with this one here. This is him being introduced at Harper's Ferry.
Cattle and horses and so on. So I thought it would be a very interesting subject to have the group listen to. I know he was at a conference last April in Beverly, West Virginia, where he delivered the same talk. So let's give Cameron a warm welcome.
Sounds like there's a lot of people there.
So I'd like to give my thanks for this to come here. I started this journey with studying.
Like he just starts right out.
Mom
just
and
comes
I were
out.
Like...
Right, you were there.
Because they actually introduced that he had friends because and Janelle was there. And he had friends and family there in the audience. And they welcomed everybody, which was really nice.
Now, what was their reaction?
We were in the front, so I couldn't even see. Mom and I were just like,
"Holy shit!
Why is he saying that? Yeah. Who is this? And why does he talk like that? That's not our Cam."
And a lot of those, I had to look some of those words up there because it might not have made sense to you at home. I had to look; those are like historical. West Virginia slang words for body parts
and historical slang.
Oh
like cuss words. Yeah, like Civil War cuss words.
A lot of people. So here he is listing some counties, and I didn't know this. They think they changed some of these names, but West Virginia has some counties that had some pretty dirty names at one point.
I remember that.
Yeah.
The area is. What is Grant County today was then during the Civil War, Hard County.
Hard on County. Oh, so I see now I said it.
Yeah.
Leap
that,
the areas also is talked about as Tucker County, Randolph, Pendleton. Those are the five main counties of operation so far of the Swamp Dragons.
I gotta hear that again.
Today was then during the Civil War, Hard County. Areas also is talked about as Tucker County, Randolph, Pendleton.
Oh man, West Virginia, what have you been up to?
That's rich.
So then
those would have been technically Virginia counties.
That's true. That's a great point.
And then West Virginia changed it.
Yeah.
I think he actually, you might have not put that section in his talk, but I'm pretty sure that's how he explained it.
That's a great point, Veronica. Virginia had the bad names, and West Virginia came along and said, "Now, wait a minute.
Yeah.
This ain't right.
Right.
We got to clean this up.
And we're not going to call it Effer County anymore. We're going to call it Tucker County or something like that.
Right.
Yeah. All right. Let's see. What is another one here? I don't know. Okay, this might be more Swamp Dragons here.
The Swamp Dragons are not your typical band of Union Militia. John Boggs was quoted, this is quoted in the Wheeling Intelligencer, that he actually told John and Bowdoin that as long as there's a Union loyalist in the mountains of West Virginia in Pendleton County, we will hold against you. We will not in your cause. They would continue to fight the whole war.
I remember that part. I thought Kathy was.
Poor Kathy.
Yeah. But in fairness, again, he was quoting what the guy said. So, I mean, right, you know, right. Yeah.
It's not
you
really
can't,
him
you
saying
can't,
it.
No, you can't. You have to do history justice and just
quote.
Say what it, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Against you. We will not in your cause. They would continue to fight.
Oh, God. And here's where he just kind of lists dirty things. I don't even know.
But one time in this area, the only people defending this section of Union line into what's now West Virginia was the Swamp Dragons. And the history that I've uncovered in this is unbelievable.
I love how you could hear the feedback trying to start too while he's talking. Like,
yeah.
To figure out everything I've shared here with you tonight, I've literally had to go circles, I did it together.
The people were appreciative, from what I recall, of all the hard work he put into this, because he did do a lot of. Can I beep it out?
Okay, a lot of bleeping. Yeah.
A lot of bleeping.
Oh boy.
This
okay.
This might be my favorite ever.
All right, let's see here. Now.
He said he nearly wrecked on the beltway just now.
So here. Now I'll give you some of the stuff I had to cut out of the Matt Atkinson talk,
oh,
okay?
Yeah.
So for those of you who don't know, over the winter, Matt was giving a lecture about John Hunt Morgan. And Cam, I guess, saw him in the visitor center and said, "Hey, you doing John Hunt Morgan? You should do how Averill kicked him out of West Virginia." Always pulling it back to what he's interested in, right? And so Matt, I guess, I don't know how it worked out, but somehow Matt got permission to allow Cam to go up afterwards. Now, it wasn't put on their YouTube channel. Matt said, you know, if you got to leave, you could leave, but I invite you to stay for a 15-minute presentation from Cameron Mallow about Averill pushing him out of West Virginia, blah, blah, blah. And so a good number of people, you know, got up and went to the bathroom or whatever they had to do, and then a good number of people ended up staying, you know, coming back in. Yeah. I mean, it was a pretty good-sized crowd.
Right.
Now,
awesome.
You were at both, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, which had the bigger crowd?
Well, the Gettysburg one.
Gettysburg one?
Yeah, I mean, because
the West Virginia
table,
one sounded like,
no,
it was a lot of people.
There were probably 40 people, but okay. it's a small, it's like a church,
sure.
Little, you know.
So it was echoing.
Probably
area. That's
yeah.
why,
yeah. It
held any more than that.
Pardon, honey?
It couldn't have held
yeah.
any more than
no,
that.
No.
But it's a nice, yeah, don't get me wrong, the West Virginia Roundtable down, I don't even know if it's actually called Harper's Fair, but it is a nice organization. And they
oh, I'm sure.
do dinner before, and the ladies
oh,
cook
wow.
for them and
oh.
everything. Yeah,
what'd
like,
you have for dinner?
Legit. We didn't go for dinner.
Oh.
We just got there right for the presentation. But
was it like spaghetti and meatball? You remember what it was?
No, it was something like meatloaf or something.
Oh,
it was
okay.
like potatoes.
Did Cam have
like
a stain on his tie?
No.
Okay,
Cam,
good.
Cam
I'm glad to hear
good.
That.
Cam was
good.
Sharp.
So let's see. There's so this is stuff that I had to cut out. And this is, by the way, the beauty of editing. And if I have to pat myself on the back, I'm a pretty good editor. I'm good at making it sound like there's no edit.
Sorry, man.
Okay?
Uh-huh.
And so when you go and listen to the release of the audio of Cam's lecture back in the winter, you can't tell where the edits are. Okay? But now here's what I cut out.
Well, a few weeks ago, right before Christmas, I was talking to Mr. Atkinson over here about John Hunt Morgan. I got real excited, and I told him about Island, and then I got talking about Averill against John Hunt Morgan down in the western southern end of Virginia. And William Averill, of course, is a very well-known from West Virginia. So the purpose of my talk, of course, is to talk about the off against John Hunt Morgan during the Civil War and the May 1864 expedition against the Virginia Tennessee Railroad and discuss this Union General Averell.
I had to get that snort in there. Now, so there's more on Averell. Let's get into that.
Give you a little background in his earlier duties prior to him coming to Virginia. He fought following the Union defeat at the Battle of Chancellorsville. Hooker, who had him relieved and would be sent to Virginia.
Okay. Dirty people back in the Civil War, by the way.
I don't know how you did it. I'm dying right now. There's no way I could have finished.
You just found the vulgar words and bleep them out.
Yeah,
I don't understand
it's not. There's nothing to do, Colby. Yeah. I just listen to the curses and I get rid of them.
Worth that Patreon subscription.
For the record, folks, this is why you don't have another narrative episode, because Matt's too busy.
And I love how your latest terror gets me is all about the narrative.
Yeah, that's right. People didn't get on. So, yeah, that's right. Sorry. Shoot. I'm gonna have to remember my audience.
Listen, you know what, though? You're compelling me to start really thinking about maybe sitting down and doing it. All right, here's another one about Averell.
John Hunt Morgan would later write of what happened at Saltville. Averell fought his men elegantly, but our boys gave them no time to fight. If I had been 1 hour later, this place and the lead mines would have been lost. If we would have had 2 more hours of daylight, we would have the whole command. At Wrightsville, Virginia, Averell collided at Cove Mountain near Crockett's Cove against a combined force of John Hunt Morgan and William Jode.
I gotta listen to that again. That's my favorite one.
John Hunt Morgan would later write of what happened at Saltville. Averell fought his men elegantly, but our boys gave them no time to fight. If I had been 1 hour later, this place and the lead mines would have been lost. If we would have had 2 more hours of daylight, we would have the whole command. At Wrightsville, Virginia, Averell collided at Cove Mountain near Crockett's Cove against a combined force of John Hunt Morgan and William Jones.
Crockett's Cove gets me, dude.
Yeah, Crockett's Cove made me laugh the first time. I don't know why. And then finally, something about Battery G.
They came on with their usual yell. The Battery boys let them have it red hot. Then with horses that they had just gotten during the night. Pulled out. Pioneers made their final with the fell across the road, completely blocking it.
Your poor niece. This is wild.
This is what she said.
This is wild. Katie has no idea what's going on.
Oh, that poor girl.
The red hot part wasn't even edited.
No.
That's actually what he said.
Yeah.
They gave it give you a little background in his earlier duties prior to him coming to Virginia. He fought following the Union defeat at the Battle of Chancellorsville. Hooker, who had him relieved and would be sent to Virginia. John Hunt Morgan would later write of what happened at Saltville. Averell fought his men elegantly, but our boys gave them no time to fight. If I had been 1 hour later, this place and the lead mines would have been lost. If we would have had 2 more hours of daylight, we would have the whole command. At Wrightsville.
Okay, we got it.
Virginia.
Okay.
You're gonna kill me in here. I can't handle it, dude. That is too much. I don't know how you finished it.
Well, you know, gold. I had to. What?
Thanks, Tom. Homespun gold.
Thank you, Tom. I'm glad you enjoyed it. Oh my God. Yeah, let me see here.
Chancellorsville
is my favorite one. Lydia Leister would be another good one for Debbie Jones says. I agree with that. Yes, let's see. who was a Canavan homespun gold, I would have tackled Cam. Chantlersville. Oh, wait a second. No, I forgot. Cindy, why didn't you remind me? My favorite one here. This one. Wait, where is it? Hold on. There are a couple of them. Here. This one, speaking of Tim Matthews, this is prompted by a question from Tim Matthews from the winter lecture. Here we go.
What about your reenacting? When did you start that?
I started that probably back in 2001 as a young reenactor who in a camp in a little Malta uniform. Some guys took me under their wings, started shitting, and little by little I grew. I learned how to get around to reenactments.
Okay, so that's how we got started in
little by little
reenacting. He was shitting in the camp.
Little by little.
And then this one here. This was a nice touch at the end there.
Train whistle?
No.
Cameron does a nice train whistle right now. Thank y'all.
That would be a great way, you know.
Mic drop, and yeah. After he goes, whoop, whoop, and just mic drop.
Yeah. And that's all I have to say about Avril.
He did it with taste, man.
Yeah, he did.
Off,
yeah,
he was. Off, you know.
Yeah, he was. At first, he was like, "No." He's being all humble and demure, and he's like, "All right, fine." But yeah. So anyway,
well,
now
he told me he was a little bit embarrassed that he went through a lot of the accounts and things like that, and he was. He wanted the audiences in both places to make sure that they understood, like, the full, you know, the quotes and everything like that.
Sure.
And some of them were a little off color, but he figured it was important for the people to get a full taste of what was going on and the way these guys talked back then. And
it's history.
You know, he was a little bit ashamed that he had to say it, but he was off the hook, so
he's
to speak, because it wasn't his own words. He was just saying
just quoting somebody.
Said,
yeah, of course.
John Hunt Morgan would later write of what happened at Saltville. Avril f***ed his men elegantly. But our boys gave them no time to f***. If I had been 1 hour later, this place and the lead mines would have been lost. If we would have had 2 more hours of daylight, we would have f***ed the whole command. At Wrightsville.
Who cares about Wrightsville? Sounds like they had a good time there. Oh, boy. All right. So lest anyone think that was real.
Yes.
That's unnecessary censorship.
Right.
When, you know, when it sounds like he's saying the F word, it's typically fight or fought.
Yeah, right.
He fought his men elegantly. So, and of course, Cam's hearing this probably did drive himself off the road.
Yeah, we're teasing around.
Yeah, yeah. And you know what, Cameron? I'm sorry. I didn't.
Cam. Beep that.
What'd you say?
Nothing.
Oh, no.
We're teasing Cam.
Yeah, we are. And
it's
because
out of love. Yeah.
As payment for you being a good sport with this, Cameron, I am going to put your full lecture up on Patreon from West Virginia, from Harper's Ferry last year, and everybody can hear about the swamp dragons.
Nice.
And you told me that I might have to take out the audio of you snoring, and I was able to isolate it. And no, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. All right, let's see here. My mother says, I just joined, but I can't begin to tell you how proud I was when I saw Matt's outfit he got for the homecoming dance. Oh, boy. Obey the walrus. What does that mean?
Katie's just being crazy.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
That's Katie.
All right. Milepost said he can't catch his breath. That's good. I like that. Connor says, this may be the funniest thing I've ever heard. Chantlersville kills me every time. This is Mike Lentz. All right. Okay. If Cam calls or shows up, you have to randomly bleep things he says live. Oh, that's funny. Well, I'll put that on the Patreon version of the show. Dear God in heaven, I'm having a heart attack, says Tim Matthews. stay away from any cans near Cam's camp.
Yeah. True story.
Harold Hahn says, oh my God, Matt, I'm milking. Wait, he can't. I'm milking with.
That's what it says.
It's what it says. I'm milking with two new employees. Listen to you in Bluetooth. They have to think I'm nuts. Started laughing till I had to lean on the parlor wall. I don't know what you're milking, but have fun. It sounds like you're in Alvarell's command. Okay.
That's Katie.
Wash your bum, bum, bum. Wash your bum. Every single day, wash your bum, bum. What? Okay.
He's talking about the last time you were on and we were talking about potty training with him.
Ah, I see.
Basically,
pooping in the toilet.
Katie is having the time of her life that her aunt is on a podcast
and she
can
just, has access to the chat.
She has access to the chat.
That's awesome.
So
that is awesome.
This is what a 14-year-old girl does.
That's funny.
God
That's
bless funny. Her. I love
well,
her.
Well, that yeah. At least she's fun, and at least she's not rolling her eyes and going, "Oh God."
Well, yeah. No, that'll be
people.
When I get home.
Yeah.
And she'll
about
be
your
reenactment. What was
when did
that?
You start that?
Yeah. What was?
I started that probably back in 2001 as a young reenactor who in a camp in a little Malta uniform. Some guys took me under their wings.
What's that?
I don't know.
Started and little by little I grew. I learned how to get around to reenactments.
That's my favorite part. Probably, the guys took him under his wings and started shitting.
I started that probably back in 2001.
Reenacting, when did you start that?
I started that probably back in 2001 as a young reenactor who in a camp in a little Malta uniform. Some guys took me under their wings. Started shitting, and little by little I grew. I learned how to get around to reenactments.
You're having way too much fun.
I know. It's too good. All right. Well, listen, we're going to take a break. We'll be right back with Veronica and Bethany's news. And maybe there isn't any news. Maybe it's just going to be gossip. We'll see. Maybe we'll do listener email. We'll talk to you later. Actually, we won't talk to you later. We'll see you later. Just a few.
For your Gettysburg business, send an email to sales@addressinggettysburg.com.
Seminary Ridge Museum and Education Center, Gettysburg's premier museum, is housed in the historic Lutheran Seminary building constructed in 1832, a witness to the first day of battle. The museum's three floors of exhibits connect visitors to the dilemmas that led to the Civil War, provide a powerful and personal view of the battle's first day, and explore one of the battlefield's largest hospitals. No visit to Seminary Ridge Museum and Education Center is complete without a guided tour of the building's famous cupola, where on the eve of battle, officers and civilians saw thousands of Confederate soldiers' campfires burning to the west, and Brigadier General John Buford watched for vital federal reinforcements as fighting erupted on the morning of July 1st. Today, you can stand where Buford stood and discover how this view helped chart the course of the Battle of Gettysburg. Your trip to Gettysburg is not complete without a serious visit to Seminary Ridge Museum and Education Center, Gettysburg's premier museum. Purchase tickets online at seminaryridgemuseum.org or call 717-339-1300. To get tickets or a cupola tour, listeners may call or walk in and mention Addressing Gettysburg, or by ordering online using the promo code AG1863 for 20% off. Seminary Ridge Museum and Education Center. It began here.
There's a devil to pay.
If you're a lover of history, then go to trhistorical.com. There you'll find apparel, drinkware, decor, and more featuring a wide range of interests from the ancient world to the Cold War. Looking to make an impression with the perfect gift? Well, TR Historical now offers gift cards and a vintage wrapping service for a truly unique presentation. And our listeners will receive 10% off plus free shipping in the U.S. when you use promo code GBERG1863. So go to trhistorical.com, TR Historical, for the love of history.
Think outside the bus and let family-owned Gettysburg Tours take you on a cycling journey across the picturesque and historic Gettysburg battlefield. There's no better way than by bicycle to gain a feel for the terrain of the battlefield. Slow enough to see it all, yet fast enough to do it all. Follow the route of Union troops entering the fray as you ride to the site of the first shots of this epic three-day battle. Feel the drama as you put yourself in the position of a Confederate soldier just before he steps off to make Pickett's charge. Take a stand with the heroic Colonel Chamberlain on the slopes of Little Round Top, just before you view the Fields of Honor beneath you from its summit. All of our guides are officially licensed by the National Park Service, so don't get a sore neck trying to see out of your car, and saddle up with Gettysburg Tours for a 360-degree view of America's most important piece of real estate. Gettysburg Tours, think outside the bus. Go to Gettysburg.com or call 717-752-7752 to book a battlefield experience you will never forget.
You've heard us promote various ways that you can help us keep the show going, but one way we haven't pushed too much is our sutlery at addressinggettysburg.com/shop. That's a shame because we have designs over there by talented artists like Ty DeWitt of 1863 Designs and Mike Stretch of the Heritage Depot. So now we're promoting it. Buying shirts, hoodies, mugs, and other items from our sutlery not only helps us keep the lights on, but it also helps guys like Ty and Mike, and it helps spread the word about the show every time you wear an item or you sip from your mug. So head over to addressinggettysburg.com/shop and grab some merch. It's the perfect Christmas gift for the Gettys nerd in your family. That's addressinggettysburg.com/shop.
Have you noticed our revamped website at addressinggettysburg.com? Well, that's the fine work of a man named Mike Stretch, and he also redid our logo for us. Both of them I originally designed, and both of them were originally horrible. But now they're nice, and that's all thanks to Mike. Mike has an awesome t-shirt company called Heritage Depot. There you'll find great designs based on Gettysburg and the Civil War with t-shirts and other types of merchandise. So go to heritage-depot.com. And spruce up your Gettys Nerd wardrobe. That's heritage-depot.com. Our favorite bookstore in Gettysburg is For the Historian, located at 42 York Street. It's because they have the best selection of Civil War books in Gettysburg, both new and used. And online, they have even more to choose from. And if the Civil War isn't your thing, that's not a problem. This is For the Historian, after all. They cover history from the ancient world to the 21st century with a strong selection of World War II and American Revolution books. It's astounding how many thousands of titles from Osprey, Savis Beattie, UNC Press, and more they have in their store. And that's because, well, they have a warehouse too. And that's where they keep all the books that are available online at forthehistorian.com. And folks, if you go to forthehistorian.com now and order books until you're blue in the face, be sure you mention that you heard about them on Addressing Gettysburg in the Note to Seller box, and they will refund your shipping costs. And if you prefer to stop by when you're in town, well, you could do that too. Just mention Addressing Gettysburg at checkout, and they'll take 20% off the retail price of your item. So go to forthehistorian.com, or stop by 42 York Street, or you can call them at 717-685-5207. That's forthehistorian.com or 717-685-5207.
Over 1 million total downloads and counting, you're back with AG Today.
La 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 la.
Now, what am I looking for? I'm looking for something here. Hold on. Where did it go? That's what I want to know, ladies and gentlemen. Where did it go, the thing I'm looking for? Here it is, in honor of our buddy Cameron. Do you remember... All right, Kim, stop.
That actually is impressive.
It is impressive.
I mean, it really is impressive.
Because there's two things going on there. There's yeah.
Wow.
You know what's funny? I saw a documentary about Appalachia or Lacha. What do they call it?
Appalachia.
And there are some people there with some pretty odd talents, but they're talents no one from anywhere else in the world can do.
I mean,
like
I grew
that.
Up in, I guess, technically Appalachia.
Yeah, and you're very talented at cleaning.
Wait.
It's true.
Didn't you clean up or grow up in Clarion?
Yeah, but they call that, they technically consider that, I guess.
Pull the mic to your mouth if you're going to turn it aside.
I know. No, you could do it. This one's different than that one.
It's the same.
No, it's not.
All right. So, yeah. So, but you, do you have any talents like besides cleaning?
When you find them, let me know.
But you would know by now. I mean, Cameron knew that he could do the whistle since he's 11 years old.
No.
Okay.
I'm untalented.
Let me ask you a question. You were here last week, right?
Yes, sir.
Did I do listener emails last week?
No, you weren't here last week. I was here last week.
Oh. Did I do listener emails last week?
You were here the week before. I don't think so.
Okay.
Why was that?
Because we were in a hurry last week. That's why. What?
You might have been helping him clean or do something.
Oh,
you were cleaning. Yes, that's why you were here. All right. Well, then, so what we'll do then is it's news time, isn't it?
You do a news or events first.
knows what's going on.
So take notes.
There's a test at the end. Here's AG Today's lead anchor, Veronica Brestensky, with news, traffic, weather, sidewalk conditions, and what's happening this weekend.
I must have all possible information.
I started that probably back in 2001 as a young reenactor who in a camp in a little Malta uniform. Some guys took me under their wings, started shitting, and little by little I grew. I learned how to get around to reenactments.
He actually says, showed up in a camp, and the guys took him under his wing. Huh?
They were shooting?
No. The full phrase was showing me the ropes,
oh.
But I cut out me the ropes.
Okay.
And then just so started shitting.
Oh, God. Oh, I do have news.
Anyway, so we really don't have any news for you.
I have news.
But Bethany just found some news. So go ahead, Beth. What
totally
do you got?
I totally burrow-vented. That's what I heard the news. I guess in Straban Township. Straban Township, the CVS was robbed at gunpoint.
Oh, here we go.
Yesterday.
Here we go.
Where is the CVS?
The CVS.
The CVS.
You know.
Okay.
Yeah,
the
it's
CVS.
Over there. All right. So it robbed a gunpoint.
They stole $2,000, forcing entry and brandishing a firearm.
Okay. Anything
that
else?
That was last night.
And that was last night over at the CVS. Okay. Well,
in the paper, though, about that. I looked at the paper today. There wasn't. So I'm wondering, and they normally don't disclose how much money they take and stuff. So I'm wondering. I saw that, too. I'm wondering where that came from.
What?
So I didn't see anything in the Gettysburg Times. You would think that would be an armed robbery, right?
Yeah,
like
yeah,
that would
yeah.
be reported. I didn't see anything today, although I didn't look at every single page.
That was a news thing.
Oh, it was a news. Oh, okay.
Okay, hold on. Wait, I thought where I was.
Because I saw the post on Burrowvent, I guess, yesterday, and I was kind of like, okay, but anyway.
I have some news for you while you're looking that up.
Oh, yeah.
Billy Webster said that he would produce Pooping on the Toilet for me, with me. And I
nice.
Said, Billy, wouldn't it be funny if that's how we made our millions? And maybe
and
it is.
That is for Ezra.
What I want to know is, how's Colby doing in there? Colby took himself what we call an edible. Colby, you feeling all right?
Rocking and rolling, man.
Yeah? Yeah. Your hair is so mussed up. I can see it through the window. And your eyes are almost swollen shut.
Dude, strong.
Yeah. It's strong, to say the least. All right, let me know if
you...
There's
some other news.
Go ahead.
This is actually, I guess, more of an event, but it's news because it's an ongoing thing. So at the Union Hotel, if you have been walking along Chambersburg Street for several months now, you would notice that they kind of had some built-out, like, partitions where the windows used to be, and they were doing some work in there, renovating. Well, it is about time for the grand opening of the Sign of the Buck restaurant.
Finally!
Yeah, so
opening congratulations.
Is tomorrow. So good luck to them and the staff.
And what kind of restaurant is it? Does it say?
It serves buck.
Yeah,
nothing but buck.
All venison all the time.
Yeah. The article I read actually said that they want to have, like, an upscale menu, but they want it to be super casual. You can come in, you know, customers can be, you know, whatever, tourists,
dressed
locals,
like
et cetera. Yeah, but they had an idea for more of like an upscale kind of, you know, I forget specifically what they were talking about, but like, you know, hummus appetizers. And
like,
you know, like,
yeah,
you know,
like Hoofin' and Fowl or Upper Crust has
the
hummus appetizer, which is very good, by the way. And like, it's pretty good. Okay, so good. So what's it called?
Sign of the Buck.
It's an ode to, or a nod to,
I think the original title of the tavern, right? Like,
that's what it was called?
I'm pretty
sure. Back in the day?
Sign of the Buck is what it was called, or the Buck?
Sign of the Buck. Because if you look at all those, like, Colonial Williamsburg and stuff, they're...
Oh, yeah.
They were, like, weird names like that. Like,
yeah, you're
like,
right.
Yeah.
Or did they have a sign that had a buck on it?
Yeah, it
could have been that,
like
too.
That.
Yeah.
Hang on. Let me see, because I know I read...
Ahead. Well, you're looking it up, and maybe, Beth, you want to look up another article or something there. I'll read it. A listener email from Keith Howe. He says, I first found you on Spotify a couple of years ago and have been listening to the free episodes. Whenever I'm having a bad day at work or my severe depression that I deal with every day hits me, your show and the Civil War Breakfast Club always get me out of my funk. The free previews you post had me interested in listening to the full episodes. I always have been interested in the Civil War since I was young and enjoy learning so much more about it, and your show has taught me things I've never known, especially when you and your guests talk about Culp's Hill and the actions of Sickles Corps. I'm a member of a group named the 28th Pennsylvania Historical Association, which said regiment fought on Culp's Hill, and I'm continually learning about them. The 147th PA and Knapp's Battery. So the actions on Culp's Hill helped me with my learning. Also, my great-great-grandfather fought in the 40th New York at Gettysburg, and learning about the action of Sickles' Corps kind of brings me a bit closer to what he might have gone through on that second day. I know you had a Get Out of the Car tour for the 40th New York, and I kick myself that I missed it. I follow the show on Facebook and Instagram and try to watch the videos you do. I also enjoy the fun you have with your guests, which is the type of person I am. Thank you for a great show. Once again, that's Keith Howe. Keith, thank you. You're very welcome. By the way, I don't do live videos on Instagram or Facebook anymore. I've moved over to YouTube because you can reach a wider audience on YouTube, and you can monetize it. And, you know, I do driving around videos. Might as well do it on YouTube because someone can actually, and people do, I think they call it a super like, where you could donate money while the video is going on live.
Okay.
Like the live video right now. And that, you know, defers the gas. Yeah. That I spend on that, because, you know, it's like 20 miles a day. I live less than a mile from work. I don't need to do that,
right?
You know, but so people quick, are
so
very cool about
Leslie
that.
Leslie McGraw and Andrew Johnson are opening a 100-seat restaurant at 29 Chambersburg Street on the first floor of their 12-suite boutique hotel. It's named after the original tavern and boarding house that opened in the building in 1804.
Called the Sign of the Buck.
Cool. Sign of the Buck. Yeah.
Interesting.
It's going to be curated from Adams County ingredients, ranging from produce and farm-raised meats to local beers, ciders, and spirits, with a Gaelic spin.
Oh.
Part of their menu, for example, is like cucumber gazpacho.
Gazpacho. That was one of my friends' name back in Patterson, New Jersey.
Steak tartare, mussels, and frites.
Yeah, steak tartare was
it
his cousin.
Frites? Frites?
Frites?
I don't know. Frites.
I always heard it frites.
Frites. Frites? Frites?
I know that's what, so
frites.
Apparently known. Frites? Okay.
Maybe you pronounce it like this.
Chaganooga.
Probably, yeah. Cheese board, meat board. They have all kinds of fancy salads. Parisian gnocchi, rockfish, scallops.
Gnocchi.
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 Yeah, I say gnocchi.
Gnocchi.
As well as just like cheeseburgers and, you know, stuff like that. So I'm excited to go check it out.
Yeah.
We actually.
When is it open? Tomorrow?
Yeah, tomorrow's the grand opening.
I can't go tonight.
Mom and I actually stayed there a couple times when we, like years and years and years ago when it was still the Gettys Hotel.
Mm-hmm.
But that was, we had some late experiences there.
My mom and my aunt stayed there, and I I went to see them and picked them up for dinner one time. And the room, I like the rooms. They're really nice.
They redid them all.
Oh, I know.
The owners redid them. I've seen the pictures. If you just go on their website, actually, they have pictures of each of the different suites and things. And
that's awesome.
It's pretty.
Well, you know, in case the owners are watching, we do always talk about how wonderful places are when we're comped.
Hey, a 100-seat restaurant sounds like we might be able to have a new venue for little events.
Oh, that's
like
true.
That.
Speaking of which, I'm glad you brought that up. Speaking of which, expectations.
Which were you speaking of?
Events.
It's not nice
so
to talk about me that way.
We've got what?
It's not nice to talk about me that way.
When I said expectations?
No, I said witch. When you witch.
Oh, speaking of which, I got you. So we've got, let's see, I spoke with Libby yesterday. We're going to do another show at the Farnsworth House in the
cool.
back there. Tentatively, Peter Carmichael will be the guest. We're going to do it Spotlight On style this year. So instead of doing it regular show style, it's just too much. Spotlight On, we sit, we talk, and eventually we'll open it up to you guys. When we did the panel over at the seminary with J.D. Hewitt and Chris Mowry, we had no plan. And I said, let's just go there. We'll ask each other some questions. And when we're running out of steam and we don't really know what else we're going to talk about, we'll open it up to the audience and we'll involve them. And then we'll have a discussion. And it worked very well.
Yeah.
And the audience seemed to enjoy it. I enjoyed hearing from the people and talking to the people. So we'll probably do it like that kind of way again. With Pete. And it's also going to be no food. I'm trying to keep the ticket. You know, last year, most people didn't care.
But some people balked that, you know, the ticket prices were too high, especially at the Adams County Historical Society. And I'll tell you what, ladies and gentlemen, we try to thank you, Grant. Thank you, Grant, for the donation. Thank you very much. There you go. You can actually do it.
Between your lines.
There you go. Read between my lines. My very subtle wink to the camera.
Between the eyes. Thank you so much, Grant. That was thoughtful.
Read between the eyes. Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry.
Anyway. So what was I talking about?
About $2.99.
I heard you. I heard you on the price when we were at Adams County Historical Society. Yeah. So here, when we first started doing the shows, you know, I always kind of go overboard, right? I always try to do too much, because I think it's impressive when you're not a millionaire if you can do something that looks like you spend a lot of money and you don't. You know, we would do things with food. And I figured we'd make an evening out of it because we are, after all, building a community. It's not just, you know, come and see the show, right? We want people to make friends and get to know each other. So we do the food. But that makes the price go up because I can't, you know, the caterer wants this much, the venue wants that much, whatever the case may be. So we're not going to do food this time. All of the things that we're going to do, there will be no food. So that's going to keep the price down a bit, not a drastic amount, because the food was not, you know, tremendous amount of money, except at, what do you call it? The Historical Society. Oh, okay. So we're not going to do food, but we are looking into doing events probably every month through the winter. I talked to the owner of Saverhood last night. We might actually do the Christmas party there. I'm not sure yet. They could fit more people. And I know there were people last year that said, well, I wanted to do it, but it had sold out. You don't have to buy a ticket for the Christmas party, and you won't this year either. But we need you to register because we need to know how many people are coming. So that's what they meant by sold out. I don't know if we've really, you know, I mean, we could fit like 250 people back there. I don't think we're going to get that many people for anything, but
well, now that
there's
Veronica
more space,
is famous.
Yes, that's true. And you, and once the that's what she said crowd starts to coalesce around you guys, you know, come out to the Christmas party and hang out with Veronica and Bethany from That's What She Said.
You know what we should do is put up like a photo booth where you can get pictures taken with us, with like a background,
at a
convention.
How about we have like cardboard cutouts of you guys with the heads missing so people can put their heads there and pretend they're you.
Pretend they're
more cardboard cutouts of you.
150 pounds too overweight.
Stop it. Yeah. That's not nice.
Extra cardboard.
Hey.
You get an extra charge for the width of my cardboard, Standy.
Be nice to my friends, Bethany and Veronica. Okay?
Okay.
Stop that.
Tell us about the Christmas party now. We can start planning our diets and then forget about them with sufficient time.
Is that all the sad music? Let me tell you.
Yes, go ahead. What bothers you?
Speaking of the whole weight thing, what cracks me up is yesterday I went to the doctor and I wasn't even in there for 5 minutes. And the woman goes, so weight management?
Oh, really?
Like, yeah, I guess.
That's awful.
So, and did you know that I was diagnosed with a fatty liver last year?
Me too! Oh, my God!
Like,
bonfire.
You really have to watch what you eat. I'm like, I watch it right into the floor, right into my mouth. Yeah, I do, but thank you for the recommendation, doctor.
What do they say is good for a fatty liver? What are you supposed to do?
Never went over that. They gave me the results of the whatever, ultrasound or sonar, whatever it's called.
Sonogram?
And fried and then foods.
Yeah, see, they know
stay like, away from dairy.
You've been really doing well with that.
Yeah. I don't eat fried foods that
What are you
much.
Talking about? We always get fried chicken, you and I.
When?
We get a bucket of KFC, and we go sit down on the rocks in
that
Devil's Den.
That doesn't count as fried chicken. That's KFC. There's two separate
Oh, that's true. It's its own thing.
I mean...
I hear that for a fatty liver, the best thing is to drink like a half a cup of olive oil every day.
No. That would be negatory.
There's all kinds of wise tales out there.
Sorry, Cameron. Sorry.
I like it.
No, I think that.
What's the opposite? Unwise tales. I prefer my
stupid
unwise tales.
Yeah, I prefer my tales.
My unwise tales. It's wives' tales,
my
Cameron.
Uneducated tales.
Kathy.
All right, here. You got another news story, or you got
no,
you want to hear?
All yours.
Oh, you're done? You have events? Yeah. You have any events?
Not really.
Come on. Find an event. Beth, go to the foundation website.
There's a book sale going on.
Yeah, there's a book sale. Get some events. I'll read a couple of these, okay?
So the Adams County Library book sale officially started today. It runs through Sunday, I believe, at the Redinger
office. I bought a few of them today.
Reading auction, not Reading.
I was doing a live video. Many people are watching now who saw it this morning. I was on Howard Avenue, and I saw Chris Presley driving the opposite direction. I waved. He stopped, did a K-turn, came back, and he goes, "You're missing the book sale." And I go, "What book sale?" And he's like, "Just go up the road there and, go through the stop signs about a mile up." He didn't have the name of the auction place, but he's like, "It's an auction place." I'm like, "I didn't know there was one." Yeah. I never go up that way. I don't know. I don't have any reason to go there.
They've had it up there. This is at least the second year, maybe the third year they've had it up
there. I couldn't believe. I have never seen so many books in my life.
Yeah.
I mean, I've been to libraries all over the place. I've never seen one this big. There were books everywhere.
Two separate rooms.
Yeah. And I was going through. I'm walking through, and I'm like, I didn't know there were two separate rooms at first. I'm walking through. I'm like, it's all like romance and true crime and fiction. I'm like, I don't want this shit. Where's the hit? Then I see the door. It says Gallery 2. And I was like, oh. And that's where history was and military history. Classics. I got books for the bookshelf here because, we need more.
Historical Society?
No.
Reading Auction out on Table Rock Road for the Adams County Library.
That's still usually from estate sales.
That makes sense.
Okay. Yeah, because
donations to the library. Yeah. I think they said it's their biggest fundraiser, and that obviously also makes sense.
Yeah,
it's a huge...
they only usually, now I don't know about Reddings, but usually they only accept certain kinds of books.
Well, it's actually the library, but they're just hosting it at Reddings.
Gotcha.
It's not an auction. It's just basically they're just out on tables.
I got eight or nine books and it was $15.
Yeah.
Like, they're really cheap.
I think they're all pretty standard. It's like $2 for hardcover.
It's $2 for a hardcover.
Size.
I think 50 cents for soft or something. I don't remember what it was, but it's definitely worth going there. And if I had realized that, I would have spent way more.
Children's books, back tomorrow. I think, look it up on the Adams County Library website, but I'm almost positive it's either Saturday or Sunday towards the end of the sale. I think you can get like 5 free books for, children can get them for families, and then teachers, it's they get some kind of thing too or whatever. And then I think Sunday is like a whole bag for like a couple bucks or something like that.
Yeah. That's nice.
Yeah.
All right. So
in the news, have we ever talked about the new library project?
No.
That they've proposed.
Do you have information on it?
They bought the land. It's over in the seminary area right in front of, the Y. Yeah. So it'll be near the Y.
Gotcha.
And now they gotta, it's gonna obviously not be tomorrow. There's gonna have to be a capital campaign that, for the building or whatever.
Right.
This campaign is
capital.
Yes. They bought the property and it's theirs.
This is what I was confused about. Are there buildings that they're gonna have to tear down on that particular piece of
property?
It
looks like yes.
Yeah. Okay. I thought so.
Now, don't quote me on that because I don't know for sure, but it looks like yes.
Is it where by the Y are you talking?
Kind of on the corner of Fairfield Road and the Seminary Road.
It's part of the seminary's property. They made a deal to get, and I thought there were a couple buildings that they said they're going to have to tear down, and then they were going to make
the
floor library or something.
It's that those brick buildings there. Are those apartments or what are those? The ones right in the corner.
I'm assuming they're dorms.
Yeah, they're the ones
dorms. Okay. Yeah.
But I mean, if you look at it from their perspective,
that building
is old. The one that they're currently in, it's very old.
Right.
And there's no parking.
Right. They can't expand.
They're right next to, bless you, they're right next to the Y. So, if there's kids at the Y and they want to take them over because there's, stuff, they can do conjunction.
What's your function?
Their events.
Yeah. All right. So here, let me, while you're looking for more things for events this weekend, let me give you one.
Just a second. There's actually a picture in case people are interested. As long as I can figure out how to hold the picture.
I judge the cupcake contest at the library.
Now that sounds fun. I want to be. How do I get to be a judge on that?
The children's librarian at the library.
I don't know that person.
Her name's Robin.
Okay, I see what you're looking at there.
Is it too close? Anyways,
Let me see if I can. Maybe I can finagle it on mine. Go to my camera.
Big piece of property, and maybe like 3 buildings apparently from where.
All right, we'll try to do. Okay, we'll do it like this and see if that.
It is. But now what do you do with that building?
All right, there we go. The YWCA. You can see that there. The parking. The Fairfield Road is where?
It would be towards the bottom of the screen.
Oh, like I see. Okay, so the Fairfield Road is down here underneath the screen. Oh, yeah. So there's a parking lot for the Y. I remember that when I used to go to the gym. And then there's the Y itself. Okay. Mm-hmm. So it's further down the Fairfield Road. I didn't know.
No, it's in front of the Y. Like, it's right. It's
No. I'm saying it's further down from the corner. It's not right on the corner. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
You better That's be sorry.
I'm excited about it. Yeah.
What is it now? I've already forgotten. We're
so,
the library. Thank you.
But like now, what do you do with the old building? Somebody's gonna have to come up in town. Yeah, with an alternate.
Give it to Addressing Gettysburg, and we'll make that our TV studios.
I bet it'll be some kind of commercial. You know, like I think that'd be a neat building.
There
for,
are
like,
the
old
coolest
or something.
Classroom spaces on the third floor.
Really?
Have you ever been up there?
No.
That's where I judged the cupcake contest, and I had no idea there were classroom spaces up there.
Do they have like the old desks and everything?
They have tables in them now.
You know what I love about Federal Point is it when you go like there's pictures of the students that went to school there, like class pictures. And we were, I forget who it was, but I was there with somebody like last year or maybe the year before. And we were going and looking at the pictures down in the hallway downstairs. And we're like, all right, let's see if we could track the kids through the years, as they get older and everything. And it's funny. And then we realized like, the really old ones, a lot of those kids might be dead already. Like, it's hard to realize. It's not hard to realize, but you got to remember that kids turn into adults and adults turn into dust.
Whoa.
All we are is dust in the wind.
It's got really
Can I get one more in here before you give me the next story here? As you're looking for the story, here we go. Patrick Burns. He says, I have been an avid listener to your free content for some time. Decided to become a patron for the premium content and the ability to ask questions. Yes, that's true. If you want to ask questions on Ask a Gettysburg Guide, any patron from the $1 level all the way up gets to do that. Let's see. So, yes, just some feedback. Didn't deter me, but may deter some, is the renew falling on the 1st versus 30 days after your signing. So today I paid full price for June, and the 1st will pay full price for July. Like I said, I certainly don't mind. I have enjoyed your free content for some time, but some feedback as it may be limiting your Patreon subscribers. Love the show. Keep up the great work. P.S. Laugh the hardest I have in years hearing your impression of your Catholic school principal. Great stuff. Thank you. Thank you, Patrick. Yeah, so that is actually something that Patreon sent an email out a year or two ago, and they surveyed all of us, creators. The question was, do you want to restructure how people get paid? So would it be, on the 1st or 30 days from when? So if you sign up on the 15th, right, you're going to get billed on the 15th of every month.
Right.
I forgot what I answered, but
must have been the 1st.
It must have been the 1st.
It must have been.
Well, no, they haven't made a change yet.
Oh.
So when they do, I'll see how they've worked it, because they got to survey everybody and then take everybody's input and then see what they want to do. So
that everyone was like, leave it the same.
No.
Huh.
No, because you get access to everything, I guess. I don't know why they don't prorate it, though. They should.
Yeah.
That would be the simplest solution, is just prorate it. It's a computer. I'm sure you could figure out a way for it to calculate,
You're the only patron I support, whatever you call that.
Rightfully so.
I don't know how that works. I don't know if there are options I don't even remember. I think I signed up for auto pay and it just does it. So I don't know.
And that's the other thing too, is, you're part of the show. You're a patron. Mm-hmm. I feel like you should get that for free, but they don't have a way for us to gift it to people. Cause I remember when the great Trinetti was in high school and he wanted to, but he's in high school. He didn't have the money to do it and everything. And he'd asked, is there a way that you can gift it to me? And I was like, there's no way that I can just take this. And I was like, that sucks, because there are some people I would like to gift it to. And of course, if you're working on the show and helping with the show, you shouldn't be paying. But of course, you want to support your buddy Matt, and you want to hear the wonderful episodes that are over there. And you can't do it, Veronica, unless you're a patron,
Right. I'm not a patron, but I clean.
you clean.
I was getting a bottle.
I would give you a free one
when I signed up, but I don't know. I'm still waiting for that. So
it's a different patron. Uh-oh. This is patron, not patron. There's no accent above the O.
Chandlersville.
Chattanooga too. Don't forget Chattanooga. It's Chandlersville.
Oh my gosh, that's a song. Chattanooga.
Chattanooga
too.
Chattanooga.
How does he say it?
Pardon me, boy. Is this the
Chattanooga?
Choo choo.
Chattanooga. No.
Chattanooga is the real one.
Yeah, yeah, I know.
Chattanooga is the cam
Chattanooga.
One.
Chattanooga.
Yeah.
Choo choo. I think is what you should.
Chattanooga.
Chattanooga. Oh my God. Now I'm going
to forgive me on the name. Chattanooga.
Bonfire.
Kathy.
Here, let me get another one in here. Joshua McDowell said, do you have events, anything? Are you looking at things while I'm reading these? I'm trying to stall for you guys.
Oh.
Oh, boy. Just give me two events that the foundation has going for the weekend.
Okay.
Do you see this professional?
The new Clean Mott's.
Yeah. There you go. Keep talking amongst yourselves while I read this one here. Okay, Joshua McDowell says, love the show. So I started listening to the free show and got hooked. Decided to get more content and show my support. Thank you for all the hard work yourself and your team do. Josh McDowell, you're welcome, Josh. Connor Sperry says, was searching YouTube one day and came across the channel and then started listening on Spotify at work. I'm a huge Civil War buff, and I love learning as much as I can about the Civil War. I want to support things that keep history of the Civil War alive, and you guys do it in a fun way. Yeah.
Cool like that.
We do that on purpose. Thank you very much there, Connor. And the last one here, Autumn Hines. Hi, Matt. I've been listening to the free feed for a while. Honestly, I just started feeling bad about soaking up all of this free content that other people pay for. I've also listened to the Patreon episode previews in the free feed and just kind of wanted to hear more. I think you guys do an awesome job. You are super handsome, and I want to support you. I've been into the Civil War since high school, the mid-90s. That's when I was in high school. But have learned so much from your podcast. Great job, and glad to see that it keeps growing. Thank you very much, Autumn. And that's it for the listener email. Now it's time. Yeah! This weekend, where
the action is. What's there to do and see when you're in town this weekend? Here's Valerie, Veronica, to fill you in.
It's all covered.
All right, Cameron, thank you for covering it all the way from Chattanooga, Tennessee. And here's Veronica Ronnie Brestensky with the news and weather or something.
Well, I'm going to give a shout out to our listeners today, actually. Okay. I'll start off with Kathy. Kathy reminded us to remember about the farmer's market. It's in full swing.
Kathy.
Mm-hmm. So it is still every Saturday, right, at the farm, at the new location just this summer.
Yes.
Which is over at the rec park.
Which I really like.
I like it a lot, too.
You kind of feel like you're in a farmer's market because there's grass there and you're not trees out in the middle of the parking lot. Yeah.
I like it a lot. So thanks, Mom. That's one suggestion.
Thank you, Kath.
Obviously, not obviously, I want to say that. Debbie Jones also typed in here, even though she's 5 feet away, living history on the battlefield this weekend at Pitzer's Woods and the PA Memorial. Ron Casula reminded us all that the military weekend at the World War II experience is happening this weekend.
That's right,
I
yes.
I think those are the only ones from listeners, so thank you all. I appreciate that. When I didn't think I was going to be here today, that's my excuse for not having anything prepared. So thanks for coming to my aid and rescuing.
And you, Bethany?
I don't have an excuse. There are still tickets for the August 5th Evening with a Painting at 5 p.m.
Can I say something about that? Ladies and gentlemen, if you have not been to the Evening with the, or any Evening with the Painting, and you are going to be around, what did you say, August 5th?
August 5th is
you've got to do it. You've got to do it. Is Sue doing it? She's not doing it anymore.
No, it's Chris Brenneman.
Okay. Regardless of who's doing it, it's just so fascinating and it's so cool. And you get to actually walk down on the diorama and behind the painting and you can see how the illusion works. I'm telling you, if you're one of these people who loves behind the scenes stuff and how it works and you watch those shows and things like that, you really have to do this. Maybe not on the 5th if you're not available, but you do yourself a favor and do it at some point.
Through the end of the year.
Great. There you go.
Shows once a month through the end of the year. And they just added a new program, Evening with the Artifacts. The first one will be August 12th at 5, and you can get an up-close look at some of the artifacts in the collection. So there are tickets for that. Definitely super cool.
Neat.
You got living history on the battlefield this weekend, of course, thanks to Debbie Jones there. Mm-hmm. Did you just say that?
Yeah, we said that. Okay. We literally just talked.
Well, how about this one? God. Ron Chisouli says, military weekend. I'm just kidding. I know you said it.
Are you serious?
I met Ron last weekend, actually. Ron and his wife, Cindy. Met them at ABC.
Taps the other night. Maybe Ron Monday, did? Yes.
I didn't know he was a trumpeteer.
He's a retired music teacher for like 37 years.
Me.
This isn't the first time he's done taps. There were pictures from previous appearances, but yeah.
You know who was my student teacher in music in high school?
I do not.
Jerry Pulci.
Get out. The Jerry Pulci?
Yeah.
I don't know who the hell that is.
Yeah, you do. You all know who he is. Oh, what a night. Late December back in 63. That guy.
What a
now,
kazoo.
You may be...
He emptied his kazoo. Is that what they say? I emptied my kazoo?
I emptied my kazoo.
Isn't that one of the lines?
Oh, that's dirty. That's that should be that's like a cam speech there.
I'm pretty sure.
I emptied my kazoo. What part of the song says I emptied my kazoo? I emptied my kazoo.
What a night. Okay, sing it. Sing it. Go ahead. I bet you get to it.
Why'd it take so long to see the light? Seems so wrong, but now it seems so right. What a lady, what a night. Oh, I. And this is where Frankie Valli comes in. Got a funny feeling when she walked and emptied my kazoo.
No, there the room, it is. In the room, and then it rhymes with.
In the room, oh,
I. Emptied my kazoo.
No, wait, let me finish.
Well, you're.
Wait, let me. Now I gotta start over again. Oh, I got a funny feeling when she walked in the room. As I recall, it ended my kazoo. Oh my God! As I recall, it ended much too soon, or far too soon. Yeah,
that's not the way I've heard.
I emptied my kazoo.
Tiny Danza.
You sicko! Hold me closer, Tony Danza.
Yeah.
Excuse me while I kiss this guy.
You know the song. It's
I am a rock. I am an onion.
China Grove by
China Grove by the Doobie Brothers. What about it?
I always thought they were saying "Whoa, Tootsie Roll."
Delicious.
I don't know what. I think "Empty My Kazoo" is closer to that to what I say than "Whoa, Tootsie Roll."
Yeah, whoa, Tootsie Roll.
Really long time. And then the Who's, who are you?
Yeah.
They were saying New Orleans.
Oh,
new,
boy. New. So, you know.
How high is her
ear? I also want to point out that I do require a hearing aid in real life.
Do you really?
Yeah.
I think I do, too. I was saying this the other night. What's that? Cool in the Gang.
It ended much too soon.
Yeah, I told you.
I found a dirty song.
I emptied my cassette.
Why the hell would Frankie Valli say I emptied my kazoo?
I don't think Frankie Valli.
He was much classier than that.
I mean, it's a song about
oh my God.
You know, do you remember Kool and the Gang's Cherish the Love? Cherish the love we have. My sister, when we were very little and that song was new, she thought the words were Janistal eyes she has. And we were like, what the hell is Janistal? Like, what does that mean?
Oh, shoot.
And, yeah.
Well,
Janistal eyes. Okay, and I'll make myself look stupid, too. Elton John, back to Elton John. He just has a problem pronouncing words, I think, because...
he's British.
Sad Song Says So Much, you know that song? And it's, turn them on, turn them on, turn on those sad songs, right? I used to think it was Turtle Mung. So turtle mung, turtle mung, turtle mung, sad song. But I was like 24 when I found out what it really was.
Mung?
Nothing. It's the same as Janistal eyes. My sister and I should have been in certain classes, and we weren't. They didn't. We slipped through the cracks.
The clacks.
The clacks. See, I can't even talk. I can't understand words, and I can't speak words. What?
I still think mine actually makes sense if it was some kind of like innuendo about having sex with a woman.
At least they're real words. Like, yeah, exactly. Of course, like, it's I emptied my kazoo. But who? When is a kazoo ever full? That's what I want to know.
Good point. Touché.
I'm imagining Frankie Valli sitting there,
right,
writing.
Right, he's got his notebook rhymes? And he's like.
He goes, kazoo!
Let me see, what rhymes with soon, you know, kazoo. I emptied my kazoo.
Frankie doesn't talk.
We don't know. How do you know?
Oh, my God.
Because he talks mine like this. He's got more of this kind of a voice. He was on The Sopranos for a season or two. All right. Well, you know what I think we've done, ladies and gentlemen? We've worn out our welcome, and the air conditioner seems to have turned off, and it's getting hot in this room.
Yeah, it is. So, yeah, what happened?
You know what the problem with the AC is? It's set on some kind of automatic timer thing, and we can't – there's no manual option.
Oh.
So we can't figure out how to get it. Like the previous tenants, we'll figure it out eventually, probably when we don't need it. But
it'll
yeah.
turn on in January.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So that's it.
This has been a lot of fun.
Yeah, we had a lot of fun. Thanks for being a sport, Cam, even though you probably didn't know you were a sport because you were not participating. But go over to Patreon. Check out Cam's speech about the swamp dragons and everything. We'll see you next week.
Addressing Gettysburg Today is produced by Matt Callery and Veronica Brestensky Esquire and broadcasts from the Gettysburg Museum of History Studios. Engineered by Colby Sumner and sometimes someone else. Guest accommodations are provided by the guests themselves. Who are we? Vanderbilts? But if you want us to take better care of them, become a patron at patreon.com/addressinggettysburg. I'm Huevos Grande, the voice of Addressing Gettysburg. Thanks for listening.
Chattanooga.
I love this podcast.
This concludes our broadcast day.
John Hunt Morgan would later write of what happened at Saltville. Averell f***ed his men elegantly, but our boys gave them no time to f***. If I had been 1 hour later, this place and the lead mines would have been lost. If we would have had 2 more hours of daylight, we would have f***ed the whole command.